there was, as there is now, an ever-increasing need for inexpensive power generation.
Oh, you have a lot of friends, of course, but you couldn't hear much because of the machines.
You know, I haven't been here for such a long time. I'm sure lots of things have changed. There's not one bad memory I can think of at all.
I came to work on the Rheidol hydroelectric scheme in 1959. I was able to be here this construction, which was very satisfying from an engineering standpoint and from a personal standpoint.
Very mountainous and very quiet. You never met anybody. You might see the occasional farmer if you were going up there. But on the road up there was very narrow as well.
This was a field. And the name of the field was in the Welsh name, Cae Glas. And it was owned by the farm which is down the road there.
There was, as there is now, an ever-increasing need for inexpensive power generation. Gaining the permission and the planning permission to build the scheme, one had to be very careful that we weren't in any way destroying that natural beauty of the area. And I think that that was accomplished.
The two men living there always came out and you had a chat and the dogs were in the house and all the rest of it. The dogs lived in the house then. So it was all very old-fashioned.
John and Jim, wonderful, wonderful farmers living in Nantymoch Farm. Very cultured people. Very knowledgeable people.
Yeah, I remember going with my father because he was originally from Pontarwyd, and we went to visit them in Nantymoch, the house in Nantymoch. And I didn't know what to expect really, but my father knew them well, and he was talking to them, and I was sitting there, and all of a sudden I looked up, and where the stairs were, and the chickens were coming down the stairs. And that's all I remember about Nantymoch there. And then we went across to see the chapel. It was a lovely old chapel.
The chapel had run down a bit, but there was no electricity or anything there. There was only the two lamps, and they were never lit anyway. And there was five, I think, members to the chapel. That was... But then a few others would go up, you know. It depended a lot who was preaching.
We drowned a chapel, of course, and that was a concern because there was a cemetery there as well. And we tried to locate the families of those that had been buried. We found a fair number, but not all. And the bodies were duly reinterred elsewhere. So it was done with care and concern.
I was up and down here for maybe 5 or 6 years, at least, on different projects, you know. Oh, you'd have a lot of friends, of course. But you couldn't hear much because of the machines making such a noise. You lived on in the camp, eh? There have been camps here for years. There were hundreds of men here in the camps. And if they got into any trouble in Aberystwyth, they got sacked no matter who they were or what they were. I was in the tunnel. Well, it wasn't very nice, very smoky. There were diesel locals that were taking the stuff out. You know, at the beginning there was diesel locals, but there was electric ones in the end. Well, it was a 12-hour day, and it was two tea breaks. You started at 8 and you had tea at 10 o'clock, lunch at 1 o'clock, and then tea again at 4 o'clock and you finished at 8. There was a big mixer and all, the cement mixer here and everything. A big batching plant, they called it. And they could pick the concrete up at the, and take it out and then put it on a machine and take it down to the dam. They dig right down to the rock and they clean it like, and then they start concrete. Oh, there's as much maybe down as there is above the ground. Well, in all, there'd be a couple of hundred men working on the dam on the day, doing different things, you know. There was 8 or 10 men drilling holes first, and then they filled them with ammunition and knocked out the rock. Then there was 2 men coming on little machines that filled the skips and they took it out. Ah, some good friends. Ah, great blokes. Ah, yeah. Good laugh all the time, you know. We never took it serious. No.
I'll tell you which one is mine now. That was mine. That was mine. Trouble is, I never came outside to look in. It had a desk and a chair, a place to hang my clothes, my coat, cupboard, filing cabinet, and that was it. A typical engineer's office, not full of paraphernalia, and it worked. I didn't spend much time in the office. Hey, why would you when there's such a beautiful country to see?
Building was just to there. Well, we'd arrived by 9 o'clock. I used to have a lift in. And then first thing we'd do then, we'd have a cup of tea. We'd make a cup of tea for all the staff that was there. And then the postman would come, they'd open the post, and then they sort different things out then. And it was just clerical and answering the phone and accepting visitors in to see different people.
When I first started here, as it happened, the superintendent, his health wasn't so good. And he said to me, when he interviewed me, he said, "You start on Monday morning and come into my office and I want to see your driving license and you will be driving me about." I had a marvellous 12 months here, running him about to his meetings all over the place. And then I went back then to work with the outside maintenance gang. Years after that, in 82, I had that job there on the fish farm, which was a very good job. And I was there now for a few years, and then a vacancy came into the control room. So I tried for a job in the control room, and I was lucky enough I had that. And then I was in the control room for, I think it was 3 or 4 years. It was a big step for me to go to the control room because I wasn't electrical or mechanical minded. But I had to have a long training, 10 weeks training, and our good boys helping me out. And of course, there's no problem then. But it was different then. It's all what you call now, isn't it? Computerized. It wasn't then. It was all big panels, and you had to do things, you know, by switches, synchronize, and get this, that, and the other. I would say it's much easier now, I would have thought.
I'd just been here a week, I think, and I was going around the place now. I wasn't certain, you know, who all the men were, but I got used to them in the end, and it's a very friendly and happy place to work. And one man came up to me and said, "Margaret, will you go up the stores?" "Yes, I'll go up the stores," I said. "Will you go and get me some elbow grease?" Well, I wasn't sure, was I? So off I went up the stairs to Gwilym and asked for some elbow grease. And when I came back, I could see them all laughing.
Well, the whole population of the valley had been invited, of course. Dignitaries from the county and from the town, the mayor came. The senior officials of the Central Electricity Generating Board. Wine flowed as freely as the Rheidol River, as you can imagine.
The marquee was here. My job and my mate of mine, there were minibuses here. Well, there were people were parking down the bottom there, in the field down the bottom by the lake. And that's all we were doing all day, was carting people up and carting others back and forth all day long.
There's a big marquee there, and there was a lot of people invited there, you know. And we saw these big cars, which we didn't see many of these big cars before. I remember going around the back and somebody taking a photo of me just holding the door of the car, you know, and it looked so important then, because, you know, you never saw so many big cars that was about then.
It was a happy occasion. The project had been built. It was now going to be operating for the benefit, yes, for the benefit of the valley, but for the benefit of Wales and for the benefit of the entire grid system of England and Wales. We felt immensely proud, immensely proud.
I started as a guide in 1966. And for the first year, we had 12,000 visitors through the power station. But we had to remember how much water was in Antamoch and Dinas and how it was coming down and everything. As soon as you learned that, was very good. And of course, we went round the power station. We used to go right down to the basement as well to show them where the water was coming in and everything. And I used to like it up in the power station more than in the information centre.
You know, I haven't been here for such a long time. I'm sure lots of things have changed. There's not one bad memory I could think of at all, no. It's just lots of fun and happiness here, you know. I was very lucky as well because, you know, a lot of my friends were in town, working in town. I thought, oh, would I be better off in town? But no, I think I was better off here. It was very, very homely here, you know.
Before the power station was built and there was a talk that they were going to build, they didn't think that it was in the ideal place or anything. But after it was built, a lot of locals had work here as well. And now, of course, they're very, very proud of it. And very proud of people coming to see it as well.
This will last much longer than any coal-fired power station, much longer than any nuclear power station. This is going to outlast you and me and you and you. It'll be here and it'll be generating power when we've long lost and gone. Yeah, I wish we'd built a hell of a lot more.